Okay, guys, so let's start today's session. And today's session is focused on one of the landmark judgments, one of the landmark case laws, which is particularly relevant in an Indian context because it is one of the most famous judgments which have been released or which has been showcased by Indian government and the Chief Justice of India. At that point in time, the Chief Justice of India was Mr. Kapadia. Mr. Kapadia is one of the leading tax judges of the country, and his judgments of direct taxation, which are related to direct taxation, are worth reading. Be it issues on capital versus revenue, be it issue on TDS, be it issue on advance tax, be it issue on any other section of Income Tax Act, Mr. Kapadia's judgments have been a landmark and they are repeatedly read by the tax consultants of the entire country. And one such judgment, one such event is in front of us. Today we are going to discuss the much coveted, the much talked about case law, which is the Vodafone case. And guys, let me tell you, not only in India is it talked about, of course, the tax professionals of India, some of them have read these cases so many times, this case so many times that it's on their tips. So some of the tax professional can tell you that para number so-and-so, paragraph clause number so-and-so of the judgment reads as under. This is the kind of repetition which Indian consultants have done of this particular case law. And this case law is not 2-3 pager case law. I mean, Delhi High Court case law ran into several and several hundreds of pages. And similarly, Supreme Court case law was also a very hefty, very detailed case law on the subject. And wherever you talk about direct taxation and that too in Indian context, you know, so I was dealing with a lot of MNCs in the entire world. So I used to talk to many big direct tax consultants in USA, in Canada, in Australia, in Singapore. And one thing which all of them wanted to ask was that what is a Vodafone case? And they have also read the Vodafone case. So they used to discuss Vodafone case with me. So this case is not only discussed in India, but this is discussed in the entire world because in entire world's history, it is one of the very few instances where a retrospective amendment has been done, which means that law has been amended from 30 years past to bring someone into tax net. So this retrospectivity element, which is there in this particular case law, is talked about, is discussed in the national forums and international forums along the globe. The world tax media and tax consultants are reading this particular case law and they are curious that what has Indian government done in this particular case law. And yes, you have already studied chapter number 2 of your syllabus, which is the residential status and the basic concepts. And this entire judgment is based upon your first two chapters of your syllabus, which is the basic concepts of income tax and the residential status. Particularly, I have asked you to read three sections of the Income Tax Act, Section 5, Section 7, Section 9. Although this case law involves a lot of more sections, a lot more sections were discussed, but I will primarily base my discussion on the on these three sections and how were these three sections exploited by the Supreme Court bench and now the International Court of Justice. So this case law was after passing through Supreme Court case law and after passing through the retrospective amendment, this went to the International Court of Arbitration, which is located in Hague. And I'll tell you a brief history about Hague also. But first, let me start with the basics. So let's start the landmark ruling, the ruling which has been talked about for past 2007 was the year in which all these things started, and we are sitting in 2020. So 13 years, this decision has been in news for 13 years, and this decision has been important for all the tax professionals across the globe because this touches the basics of income tax. Basic charging sections of income tax are being dealt with in this particular case law. So the presentation in front of you demonstrate the fight, the sort of agony between the Union of India. Union of India means central government. The Income Tax Act represents the Union of India versus the Vodafone, the company Vodafone. And this company Vodafone is also known as the assessee. Assessee is the word which is being used for the company who's being assessed. So assessee is the Vodafone, and the person who is fighting against the assessee is the Union of India. which is represented by the Income Tax Department. And yes, while I'm going through the PPT, while I'm scrolling through the PPT, if you have any questions, please put them up and I'll be answering them one by one, because if my speed is too fast, then you might not be able to understand certain things. Then please halt me at that point in time and ask me questions if you have any questions. Okay, so are you guys excited? How's the josh in the room? Are we set to start the PPT on the world's famous 21,000 crore tax liability case law, Vodafone? How's the josh? Good. Ankush says hi. Amazing. Anjali, hi. Okay, Talib, Sapna, Komal, hi. Shubhi, hi. Priyanshi, hi. Fantastic. Shubhangi, Charu, Mahipal. Very good. Neha, Nidhi. Perfect. Rahul, Bijendra Kumar. Perfect, perfect. Perfect, guys. Let's start this case law, which is the Vodafone case law. And yes, you are aware about this gate, which I've been discussing with you for the past few days now. So guys, this is the entry gate. This is the entry point of Income Tax Act. These sections are the entry point of Income Tax Act. If someone wants to enter the Income Tax Act, it has to enter through these sections. These sections are the sections which tell you what is income. If your income is not categorized under any of these four sections, then you are out of the Income Tax Act. If you want to get income, any income of any person under purview of the Income Tax Act, then the entry point, then the gate of entering into the Income Tax Act is this particular section, section 5, section 7 and section 9. As pointed out by many of you rightly while we were discussing in our WhatsApp group, guys, if Income Tax Act wants to charge itself, if Income Tax Act wants to levy tax on any person, then it has to classify the income in any one of these four blocks, which we can see. So income should either be received in India, which means it should be monetarily received in India. Income can also be deemed to received in India, which means that it is not received in India, but I'm assuming Income Tax Act is presuming that it is received in India. This is deemed to be received in India. Third is accrue or arise in India. And this concept is an accounting concept, which we have studied since our 11th standard, that whenever some income falls due, it is chargeable to tax. So need not recover the money. Money can be recovered after, say, 1 year, 2 years, 6 months, 3 months, 2 months. But if the money, the income is due, if the money income is accrued, then we have to pay taxes on that particular income. Accrue or arise in India. And last but not at all the least, in fact, the most naughtiest one, the most scrupulous section, the most harsh section, section 9, deemed to accrue or arise in India. Even if your income is not accruing or arising in India, it will be deemed to accrue or arise in India if it falls under section 9. So this is the entry point of Income Tax Act. This is how incomes can be taxed under the Income Tax Act 1961. Now, tell me out of your study of your chapter number 2, guys, would Income Tax Act be worried about these four income, whether they are falling under these four category or not, for a resident, yes or no? I want an answer in the chat box. I repeat my question. My question is, would Income Tax Act be worried whether income of a resident be falling under these four categories? Yes or no? Which, so B means Income Tax Department. So yes, we want the assessee to be Hutchinson International. But the question is, how is the income received in India? Answer, yes or no? We have to. So Hutchinson International is a non-resident. For a non-resident, you have to fit it in one of the blocks. If it is not fitting in one of the blocks, then he is tax-free. So is the income received in India? Answer yes or no in the chat box. Answer yes or no in the chat box. Is the income received in India? Answer is no, sir. It's not received in India. Question number 2. Is the income deemed to receive in India? Is the income deemed to received in India? Because deemed to receive in India has specific clauses. None of the clauses is getting fulfilled in this particular transaction. So the income is not deemed to be received in India. Question number 3. Is the income accrued or arise in India? Does the income accrue or arise in India? No, no. Before telling a no, I want a reason for it. Why are you saying no? Why the income has not accrued in India? I want a reason. So who wants to answer this question? You have to unmute yourself and tell me, why is the income not accrued or arise in India? I understand received and deemed to be received is not there for sure. But why accrue and arise is not there? Anyone who wants to answer? You can just type in the chat box, me. Ankush Yadav. Okay, Ankush, you can unmute yourself. Just unmute yourself and tell me, why is the income not accrued or arise in India? No Kalyani. We are not talking about connection as of... We are not talking about connections as of now. Connection is deemed to accrue or arise in India. Connection is not accrued or arise in India. Deemed is... connection is in deemed to accrue or arise in India. Ankush Yadav. Where is Ankush? Ankush, please open your camera and microphone and tell me why the income has not is not accrued or arise in India. Ankush, open your camera. Ankush.
Yes, sir. It is deemed and arise in India.
No. I'm not talking about deemed. I'm talking about why is it not accrue or arise in India. I'm talking about accrue or arise. I'm not going to deeming section 9. Why is it not accrue or arise in India? What is the condition required for accrue or arise in India? Anyone can answer this question. Whosoever wants to answer this question. Priyanshi, open your mic and your camera. Priyanshi, open your mic and your camera. Why is this income not accrued or arise in India?
Sir, because it is not fall due in India.
Perfect answer. What is the thing, relevant thing, which you will see to notice whether it is falling due in India or not?
Sir, connection.
No, connection is in deemed to accrue or arise. Connection is not in this section. How would an income fall due?
Deal.
Perfect. The deal should have happened in India. Right to receive should have happened in India. Right to transfer should have been executed in India. The contract should have been signed in India. The shares or the property for which contract has been entered into should be in India. Nothing is there in India. The deal has not entered into being entered in India. Transaction has not been entered into in India. The transaction has happened between two non-residents. That two non-residents outside India. The shares were also not of Indian company. The property was also not of Indian company. So nothing is there to prove that this particular income has accrued or arise in India. So now Priyanshi, answer, which is the only block left in which we have to club our income, which is the only one block left?
Deemed to be accrued or arise in India.
Perfect. So the entire income tax department was after life of Vodafone to qualify this income, which I have shown you in this diagram, which is the income of Hutchinson International Cayman Islands, to qualify it under section 9, which is deemed to accrue or arise in India. I have already proved that received is not there, deemed to receive it is not there, accrue and arise is not there. So the only option left is that now this income should fall under section 9, which is deemed to accrue or arise in India. Now, I will walk you through the four legs. So like horse has four legs, cat has four legs, dog has four legs. All the animals have four legs. And even human beings have four limbs, two hands and two legs. Section 9 is based upon four legs. Now you need to pull out this Hutchinson transaction in section 9, because you are a tax officer and you have to qualify this transaction under one of these four things. Okay? Now think. All income accruing or arising, whether directly or indirectly. Option number one, through or from any business connection in India. So now answer my question. Hutchinson International had a global business. its subsidiary was Indian entity.
Yes, sir.
Please mind my words. Subsidiaries, Indian company was there. So Hutchinson was merely holding the shares of the CGP investment company. Is there any business connection between Hutchinson International and Hutch SR? I want answer in chat box, yes or no. I want answer in chat box. Is there any business connection? Sapna, itni bhi lalchi mat bano yaar. सबके सर पे ना इस समय लालच सवार है, क्योंकि सब बस तुले हुए हैं कि बस हचिनसन इंटरनेशनल को किसी तरह इस सेक्शन में लाना है. सब पे इस समय लालच सवार है. कोई पढ़ नहीं रहा सेक्शन ढंग से. सेक्शन पढ़ो ढंग से. थ्रू इनकम शुड अराइज थ्रू और फ्रॉम एनी बिजनेस कनेक्शन इन इंडिया. गाइज द शेयर्स आर बींग ट्रांसफर्ड ऑफ हचिनसन इंटरनेशनल. द शेयर्स आर बींग ट्रांसफर्ड टू वोडाफोन. There is no business connection in India because the shares are not belonging to Indian company. Yes, subsidiaries holding some investment, but business connection, there is no business. Hutchinson International doesn't have any business connection in India. Please understand this fact. Please understand the words through or from. Through means there is some something which is hitting. So if I am saying that I am holding shares of Reliance Industries Limited, if I am holding shares of Reliance Industries Limited, the dividend which I get, I am earning income from Reliance Industries Limited. Now suppose Reliance Industries Limited purchases crude oil from some XYZ vendor. Of course, Reliance Industries Limited is deriving its business from that crude oil. It processes that crude oil and earns income. Can I say as a shareholder of Reliance Industries Limited that I am earning income from that vendor who is supplying crude oil to Reliance Industries Limited? Can I say that? Far-fetched. It is very distant. It is not rational to say that. I am not earning income from that crude supplier. I am earning income from Reliance Industries Limited. I am earning income from Reliance Industries Limited processing of crude oil into petrol. So again, an interpretation issue, but I feel that, and Supreme Court also felt that, it is not falling under category of through or form any business connection in India, because there was no business connection in India. Only holding shares doesn't mean you have a business connection in India. Business connection means you are doing some activities, you are doing some business in India, and you means international. Hutchinson International is not doing any business in India. There is no business connection in India. Okay, let's move on to the second clause. Through or from any property in India. Through or from any property in India. Mind you, the shares are belonging to Hutchinson CGP Investment. CGP Hutchinson International. Shares are of Hutchinson International. Property is shares. So is this income derived through or from any property in India? That is the big question. Answer, yes or no? Through or from any business, any property in India? Again, yes. Most of you are right. Answer is no. Property is not in India. Property is in Cayman Islands. So you cannot say that it is derived from property in India. Next, through or from any asset or source of income in India. Is the source of income in India through or from any asset or source of income? International's business income's source is source in India. Again, a question mark, interpretation issue. Okay, next, through the transfer of capital's asset situated in India. Fourth limb, through or from the transfer of capital assets situated in India. Yes or no? This one is for sure no. Because capital asset is not situated in India. This one is for sure no. There is no asset in India. Okay, perfect. We have analyzed the section, guys. And now let us read what Mr. S.H. Kapadia, the Chief Justice of India at that point in time, this matter was presented in front of him January 20th, 2012. This matter was presented before S.H. Kapadia, the Chief Justice of India at that point in time. He was assisted by two judges, K.S. Radhakrishnan and Swatantra Kumar. Always remember, Supreme Court always has benches. So this was a three-judge bench. Then it will have five-judge bench. Then it will have seven-judge bench. Then it will have nine-judge bench. Can you tell me the rationale of keeping odd number of judges? Why not a two-bench judge? Why not a two-member bench? Why not a four-member bench? Why a three-member bench or five or seven or nine? Why odd number? Why not even number? Why can't judges be in even number? Perfect, perfect. Valid reason to get some answer. It should not tie, because if it ties, then our purpose will be defeated. The option should be clear. If one of the judges refuses, then if two are agreeing to the matter, then matter can be taken forward. So three judge bench, five judge bench, seven judge bench and nine judge bench. These are the benches which are constituted in Supreme Court of India. Three bench judge was constituted. Let us read. Section 45 is the section of capital gains, which we'll be reading in our syllabus, guys. It says that capital gains, offshore transaction. Offshore means which is outside India. Territorial tax jurisdiction of Indian tax authorities. Now, what is the territory amongst which the Indian tax authorities can levy tax? What is the periphery in which income tax authorities can levy tax? Transaction between Vodafone International and Hutch International, both companies incorporated outside India, with regard to sale and purchase of entire share capital of CGP, also a company incorporated outside India, revenue seeking revenue means income tax department. Revenue means income tax department. Revenue seeking to tax capital gains arising from sale of share of share capital of CGP on the basis that CGP held underlying Indian assets, held that Indian tax authority had no territorial jurisdiction to the tax, to tax the said offshore transaction. Indian tax authority has no jurisdiction. Applying the look at test in order to ascertain true nature and characteristic of the transaction, the offshore transaction in the instant case is bona fide structure, FDI, it is a foreign direct investment in India, which fell outside the Indian territorial tax jurisdiction and as such not taxable. So the income tax people lost this case in Supreme Court, and Supreme Court decided that this particular transaction was outside the purview of income tax department. Income tax department cannot, you know, what was the logic of income tax department? Income tax department was saying, sir, this CGP investment and Intermediate Mauritius are fake companies, are shell companies. It can be assumed that there is no company between Hutchinson International and Hutch SR. It can be assumed that you can look through. Look through means if someone is standing in front of you, you ignore him. You make him feel as if he's transparent. So income tax authority was saying, sir, do not see CGP investment and Intermediate Mauritius. These are shell companies. Do not see them. It is a transaction of selling of shares of Hutch SR only. This was the logic given by the income tax authorities, which was rejected by the Supreme Court. Supreme Court is saying, please don't look through. Please look at. Please don't ignore those two entities which are in middle. Please look at those two entities also. Don't look through those two entities. So Supreme Court held on January 20th, 2012 that Hutchinson shares which were sold to Vodafone were not taxable in India. Income tax authority had no liability. Income tax authority had no jurisdiction to tax the Vodafone company in India. The Hutchinson company in India. Guys, does anyone of you knows who has fought the case from Vodafone side? Who was the lawyer of Vodafone? Who was the lawyer of Hutchinson? Name of the landmark lawyer of direct taxation. He is the god of direct taxation. I mean, his arguments were actually worthy of listening in the Supreme Court. Who had fought this case from the Vodafone side? Who was the lawyer, the biggest lawyer, one of the biggest direct tax lawyers of the country? Name of that lawyer. Anyone knows about name of the lawyer who fought the Vodafone case? Of course, guys, from the central government side, there's always the revenue lawyer who fights the case, and from the income from the assessee side, from the Vodafone side, he hires a lawyer. So who was the lawyer? Very nice, very nice. What is his name? Absolutely, Anurag. Very good. The man behind this entire theory of look at versus look through was Harish Salve, and beautifully argued case. He won 21,000 crore liability from the Supreme Court. Vodafone was actually dancing with joy and with pleasure. So, wo ad aata hai na, man mein laddu phuta, that many laddus were bursting in man of Vodafone. And this was the day, January 20th, 2012, when celebrations were going on in Vodafone because they had won in the Supreme Court, the apex court of India, the one of the biggest case laws of the country. But unfortunately, the happiness did not last for many days. Happiness was ruined within 1 month. See the promptness in which Income Tax Act reacted, Income Tax Department reacted, the promptness. Within 1 month, Finance Act 2012, which would have been released in February end, Finance Act is released. So January 20th, the judgment came, Vodafone was dancing, balle balle, shava shava. Within 1 month, Income Tax Act was amended. Explanation 5 was inserted in the Income Tax Act. Let's read the explanation 5 to section 9.1. Let us read very slowly. For removal of doubts, which means the clarification is just for removal of doubts. Income Tax Act always meant like this. For removal of doubts, it is hereby clarified that an asset or capital asset, being any share or interest in a company or entity registered or incorporated outside India. So any share or any interest in company which is registered outside India shall be deemed to be, or shall always to be deemed have been, situated in India. So you understand what this line is saying? This line is saying, if you sell shares of a foreign company outside India, then we will deem that shares were situated inside India. If now comes the golden words of these explanation guys, and beautiful words, beautifully crafted by then Finance Minister Mr. Pranab Mukherjee. The line says, if the share or interest derives directly or indirectly its value substantially from the assets located in India. So I still remember Pranab Da was there at that point in time, Finance Minister, or P. Chidambaram. I think P. Chidambaram was there who had drafted this particular line, and this line was drafted in a very, very beautiful fashion, guys. The aim was Vodafone case law. The aim was to reverse the Supreme Court case law. The aim was very clear that Supreme Court case law, which has been adjudicated in favor of Vodafone, should be reversed and Indian authorities should have the right to tax Vodafone. What is this explanation saying? It is saying that if shares of a foreign company derive its value from assets situated in India, then those shares will be deemed to be situated in India. So the shares of the foreign company which we were talking about, Hutchinson or CGP, the shares of the foreign company which we are talking about, guys, those shares will be deemed to be situated in India if those shares are deriving its value from assets situated in India. And yes, those shares have derived its value from the assets situated in India. So HSSR is owned by Intermediate Mauritius, is owned by CGP Investments, and yes, CGP investment shares have some value of HSR India assets also. So naturally, those shares of CGP investment would have some value, would have some benefit, or some portion of those shares would belong to the assets which are there held by HSR India. And with this amendment, this entire theory of Supreme Court that the four limbs of Section 9 does not cover this particular transaction got failed, because if the assets are situated in India, because we have studied the assets are situated in India. Please see this, which you all said that it's for sure not covered under this head, the last limb, through transfer of a capital asset situated in India. Guys, the Indian government used this last line, that capital asset is situated in India. If it derives its value from assets in India, it exploited this last line, which all of you said that, sir, isme to sawal hi nahi uthta, isme to fall kar hi nahi sakta hamara case. Capital asset to situated in India mein hai hi nahi. Wahin par income tax department ne, income tax government ne hit kiya, sabse soft point pe hit kiya, sabse obvious point pe hit kiya, aur bol diya that a company which derives its value from assets in India, its asset, its shares will be assumed to be situated in India. Batao zara, kya jaise hi in shares, jo CGP ke shares the, jaise hi unki shares ki value Indian company se derive hui thodi bahut bhi, to kya wo shares automatically India mein situate ho gaye? Yes sir, wo share India mein situate ho gaye automatically. Yes, those shares are not registered in India, even CGP International is not situated in India, still those shares were deemed to be situated in India, and this transaction was covered under the Income Tax Act. But sir, one very important point. Sir, transaction happened in 2007. This amendment came in 2012. Can the amendment which came in 2012, so okay, the transaction which will happen after 2012, they will fall under this explanation, we understand. But sir, the transaction which happened in 2007, can that also be incorporated in this amendment? Answer is, this is what is known as retrospective amendment. So this amendment was not made with effect from 2012 when it came. It was made effective from 1st April 1962 when this act was enacted for the very first time. Crux of the matter is, you cannot do any tax planning looking at the act, because act can be amended from retrospective effect at any point in time by income tax department. So this entire case law rendered the tax planning, the aggressive tax planning, which is done by many people, rendered it all fail, because you do tax avoidance, you do some smart techniques of avoiding tax. Income Tax Act will be amended retrospectively to give effect to give nullity effect to your smart moves or your smart planning. So yes, this retrospective amendment came, and now the Vodafone was back to square one, and its tax liability was again given a hit to 21,000 crore was being was to be shelled out by income by Vodafone. And yes, this is how Supreme Court judgment was reversed. Now what happened in 2020? Please read point number 6. In 2020, the Permanent Court of Arbitration, so there's a court of law which is not situated in India, because in India Vodafone lost its all hope, because Supreme Court judgment was not enough, retrospective amendment came in the act. So the Permanent Court of Arbitration, it ruled in favor of Vodafone. Again, rule of Permanent Court of Arbitration said, this is not fair, guys. You cannot retrospectively amend some act and render any of the tax planning or which whatever is done by the SSE falls. This is not justice, because taxation was in violation of BIT. So BIT was a investment treaty which was entered between Netherlands and India, which said that we will not unduly or unjustifiably tax any of the residents. So India undertook that Netherlands resident will not be taxed unjustifiably. Netherlands undertook that Indian resident will not be taxed unjustifiably. This was the BIT and United Nations Commissions on International Trade Law, which is actually a trade law which says that you should be transparent with each other. You should not be taxing someone unjustifiably. So yes, in 2020, this thing has happened, and few weeks back, this judgment has happened, which has again reversed liability of Vodafone. But please don't think that matter has ended now. Income Tax Department will not sleep over it. Income Tax Department, as we discuss on this live session right now, Income Tax Department's minds, the great minds in Income Tax Department, CBDT, will be working to how to again nullify this judgment which has come in 2020. So let's wait and watch what will happen. There are years to come in which this judgment might again be reopened and might again be discussed in some other way, in some other form. So guys, when Supreme Court came, everyone thought matter is over now, nothing will happen. Then came the Amendment and Finance Act. When amendment came, everyone thought nothing else will happen. Everyone slept over it. Then now in 2020, this judgment has come up. So whenever we sleep over Vodafone case, we realize that something new has happened in the Vodafone case, because the liabilities are huge. The international tax community is pressurizing Indian tax authorities to work in a typical manner, because seeing Vodafone companies suffering, many MNCs are now afraid of coming to India. They're saying, okay, no, we are afraid of coming to India. They would retrospectively amend the sections and would make our transactions fall under tax net. We are afraid of coming into India. So that is why PM Modi's initiative of Make in India is really boosting these days. And MNCs are, a little scared of coming into India. One of the reasons is the tax. So the term which is used in technical terms is that tax terrorship. So the Income Tax Department is called as tax terrorist. This is known as the tax terrorist activity. And tax terrorism is a word which has emanated from the Vodafone case. So all the world consultants would call India as a tax terrorist, and tax terrorism is the term used for Indian companies and Indian tax jurisdiction. But so be it. You call it harsh, you call it unjustified, you call it whatever you want to call it. But this is how Indian income tax is layovered, and this is how Indian income tax functions. So yes, that's all for this particular session, guys. I just had to briefly discuss with you this Vodafone case. I don't know to what extent could you understand it, because undoubtedly for a CMA inter student, it is difficult to understand such a complex case law. I don't know how far could you understand it, but I am open to questions now. If you have any questions from any of the slides, you can just tell me, and I'm happy to take any questions if you have surrounding Vodafone case. And please, first of all, tell me, could you understand, 70-80% of the Vodafone case? Could you understand the controversy? Could you understand the concept? Could you understand what was Supreme Court's decision? Then why was Finance Act amended? Could you understand all these things? Chat box, I want yes or no. Could you understand? Okay, that's great. Wow, good. So you guys are on the way of becoming tax consultants of the country, because it's a very, very complex case. It's not an easy one. If you are able to understand it, then it's very, very good. Okay, great, great. And of course, guys, those students who have studied chapter first and second, they would be able to appreciate it more, because it is all surrounding those three sections and the residential
Sir,
status
can you
concept.
Move the
so any questions?
To the second one.
Yes, Anurag.
Second slide.
Sorry?
Can you second move the slide to second one? Next.
This is the second slide.
Next. Sir, section 911. Next.
Okay. Yes.
Yeah, that's it. Sir, I'm not able to understand the business connection and property point. Can you please elaborate?
Okay. Sure. So, assume that I am in India and I want to do business in Singapore. I want to avoid Singapore taxes, okay? Because I know that if I visit myself to Singapore, or if I go and open a subsidiary, because I have to do business has to be done through a subsidiary. Company is the best form of doing business. If I open a company over there, if I open a subsidiary over there, then that company will be a resident and the income will be taxable. I, as a person, Nikhil Gupta, if I visit Singapore for more than stipulated time period, 182 days, so India 182 days, Singapore it can be something else. Obviously, it's a year long project, so I have to stay in Singapore for entire year. If I, Nikhil Gupta, visit Singapore and I stay over there, then I'll be a resident over there. And then the entire income will be taxable. I want to avoid taxes. So what will I do? I'll contact Mr. Zi Huang. So this is how names are there in Singapore also. Yes. So like Chinese name, Singaporean name are also like this. Zi Huang. So he's a Singaporean and he speak English well. And he says, yes, Mr. Nikhil, how can I help you? Tell me. This is how he's talking to me. I'm on a phone with Mr. Zi Huang. I'm telling Mr. Zi Huang, I have a unique product I want to sell in Singapore, but I don't want to come in Singapore. I want to sell it through India. I am in India. I will not come to India. I will not open a company in India. But you, as an agent, as my agent, you please sell these products in India. You sell these products in India. The money will be transferred to me by Singaporean residents. You get your commission. So the only income which is taxable in India, in Singapore, is your commission. My profit will not be taxable in India because I am a non-resident of Singapore. They will not be taxable in Singapore because I am a non-resident in Singapore. The only income which will be taxable in Singapore, which will be Mr. Xing Huang commission, which will be taxable in Singapore. That commission will be a very, very small part. I don't mind getting that taxed in Singapore, but I mind getting my main income taxed in Singapore. So what have I done? I have not done the business. In coming through Singapore, I have not done business through myself in Singapore. I have not opened a company, but I have hired a agent in Singapore, and he is doing business on my behalf. I am earning the income. I am not paying income to. I am not paying taxes to Singaporean authority. Why? I am not a resident. Now the question is whether it is justifiable or not. Answer is no. It is not justifiable because. Why is it not justifiable? Because even if I am a non-resident, the income is actually the agreement, the right to receive, the payment received is actually arising in Singapore. So this section says, even if you are not a resident, if you don't have a company in India, if you have some business connection in India, which is my business connection, Mr. Xing Huang is my business connection in India. My agent is a business connection. Oh, sorry, not in India, but in Singapore. Mr. Xing Huang is my business connection in Singapore. So what does this law says? This law says, if you have any business connection in Singapore, so I'm substituting India with Singapore. If you have any business connection with Singapore, then your income will be taxable in Singapore. Similarly, Indian tax authorities have said that, listen, if you are a non-resident, even if you are not coming in India, even if you are not having any subsidiary in India, your agreement is not getting signed in India. It is getting signed outside India. You are not doing any activity in India. You just have an agent who is calling up customer and he's saying, boss, bahut badhiya material hai, US se aayega, tum maal khareed lo. And that entire transaction is happening in USA. Still, since that agent is in India, you have a business connection in India and you are doing your business through India. If you are doing your business through India, this is known as business connection through India. In our case, Hutchinson International was not doing any business through India, did not have any business connection in India. He just held shares through subsidiary, through two subsidiaries of an Indian company. He did not have any business connection in India. And point number two, Anurag, could you get the first point? Should I move on to the second point? Perfect. Point number two, through or from any property in India. Now, Mr. John, resident of USA, has a property in Jodhpur. This is the same example which I have taken in my classes. Mr. John from USA has a property in Jodhpur. Miss Ruana from Canada wants to take that property on rent. Rent is being paid by Miss Joanna from Canada to Mr. John in USA. Income is not received in India. Income is not deemed to receive in India. Income is not deemed to accrue or arise in India because right to receive is transferring from Canada to USA. Right to receive, the due, the element of due is happening outside India. It is not happening in India. But still, it will be taxable in India because I will deem it to be accrue and arise from a property in India. That is the example of being deemed to accrue or arise from a property in India. So if you do not fall within those three primary categories, receive, deem to receive, accrue and arise, then you will fall under the residuary category of 911, which is these four sections. Pakka clear or you're just saying it for saying sake? Yes, yes, yes. So Vodafone tried very hard to escape all these four clauses. It tried very hard. Okay, so not in Singapore, but in Mauritius. So they had created a dummy company in Cayman Islands and Mauritius. These were the two step subsidiaries which were there, right? Now, to prove whether they were dummy or not is again a challenge. Whether they were entering into any transaction or whether these companies were solely created to invest in India, that is also a challenge, whether they were dummy or not. Indian authorities were alleging that they are dummies. They are dummies. Please look through them. But to substantiate, to have evidence, you have to see their transactions. You have to see what functions are they doing in Mauritius, which is not possible for income tax authority to approach them. So that is a difficult proposition to say, yes, income tax authority was saying this. But even if income tax authorities were saying this, Supreme Court says, please don't look through. Please look at that person. Don't look through. So this is how the case law was worded. Okay, any other question? Talib, any question from your side? Ankush, Priyanshi, Smriti, any question? ऐसा लग रहा है जोर का झटका धीरे से लगा. Talib is here. Oh wow. Talib, please open your camera.
Good evening, sir.
Good evening. How are you?
Fine, sir.
So Talib, please open your camera. Let us see what is the development in your hairstyle. Talib, not the voice, but the yes. So show your hairstyle. Yes. Anurag, can you enlarge his screen? Talib, move your camera upwards. Are, where are you gone? Talib, come back.
Yes, sir.
Move your camera upwards. So are you sure that these are natural?
Yes, sir.
And since ever they have remained like this. Great, great, awesome. Talib, what is the situation of residential status? Is it done now? Practice questions are also done?
Yes, sir.
You have been able to understand the practice questions well?
Yes, sir.
So ready for next week's test on residential status? So I need an answer from all of you in the chat box. Guys, are you ready for the test next week of residential status? An answer in the chat box from all of you. Yes, absolutely. Yes. Yes. Good. Yes, yes. Yes, Mahipal. Charu, yes, very good. Neha, yes, next week, perfect. Prakriti, not yet, okay, Prakriti is faltering a little bit. Devrata is yes, very good. Komal, yes, very nice. Perfect, perfect. So let's see what is your performance in the next upcoming test.